leaders too close to the United States, now risk the same fate as the deposed Shah of Iran, or worse. In 1979, Egyptian President Anwar Sadat signed the historic Camp David peace accords with Israel. In October 1981, 9 months after the Reagan-Bush administration had taken office, Sadat was assassinated by members of the Al-Jihad movement. Israeli troops moved into southern Lebanon. In retaliation, Hezbollah, an Iranian-supported paramilitary group of Shiite militants, went into action. The militant Muslim Brotherhood, which had been banned since the 50s, continued to defy Egypt's west-leaning government. Islamic militants spread throughout the region, planting the seeds of the militant Hamas, to arise later on the West Bank and Gaza Strip, and Al-Qaeda in Saudi Arabia. By and large, the response of American politicians was to demonize Islamic fundamentalism and rally public opinion against the militants in Iran who had seized American hostages. Reagan and Bush owed their 1980 electoral victory to a campaign charging President Jimmy Carter with being weak and vacillating in dealing with Iran. Bush said that the American people regarded Iran with hatred. Then he added, "I feel that way myself." But the political realities were far too complex to lend themselves to such a reductionist approach. The United States was entering a bizarre and perplexing game of three-dimensional chess, complicated by not one, but two regional wars, between the Soviet Union and Afghanistan on the one hand, and between Iran and Iraq on the other. In both cases, the United States played an enormous but low-profile role, waging covert war by proxy and, ironically, funding and financing Islamic fundamentalists whom, in other contexts, the U.S. government demonized. In the Afghanistan war, the United States supplied weapons, training, and billions of dollars to forces aiding the Mujahideen rebels fighting the pro-Soviet Afghan government. In the Iran-Iraq war, short-term realpolitik considerations and factionalism within the administration led the United States to tilt toward Iran, then Iraq, back and forth again and again, while secretly arming both sides. A vital factor in these stratagems was that Saudi Arabia had begun to replace Iran as one of the United States' primary regional allies. The United States had long had a special relationship with Saudi Arabia. But with the Cold War still ongoing and Iran no longer a friend, it became increasingly important in geostrategic terms as well. The subtext behind the new relationship could be explained in two words that are the eternal and defining pillars of American policy in the Middle East: oil and Israel. During OPEC's oil embargo in the aftermath of the 1973 Arab-Israeli War, the United States had learned about the wrath of the Arab oil-producing countries when it leaned too far toward Israel. Now, by arming the Saudis, the United States would ensure the stable flow of oil at reasonable prices. The process began with the sale of just 5 airplanes. Reagan had the reputation of being pro-Israel, but to the dismay of the Israeli lobby, one of his first decisions was to sell 5 airborne warning and control system planes, known as AWACS, to Saudi Arabia, as part of a $5.5 billion package with associated technology and infrastructure. This was the first crucial foreign policy test of the Reagan era. Dashing young Prince Bandar, who at 32 had just earned his master's degree at Johns Hopkins University, led the Saudi lobby in a fierce battle against its Israeli counterpart by getting Vice President Bush to push Reagan on the arms sale, and then dazzling senators with his wit and charm. Bandar's great success in the AWACS lobbying effort won him the coveted position of Saudi ambassador to the United States, an extraordinarily powerful post. Just before Congress was to vote on the package, the Pentagon told Washington Post reporter Scott Armstrong that the AWACS planes cost about $110 million each. When Armstrong first did the math, he mistakenly thought that 5 times $110 million must be $5.5 billion. Then he realized that a decimal point was misplaced, which meant that the AWACS sale was about far more than just 5 airplanes. What had been announced as a small arms deal was the start of something big. Where was all the money going? This was the linchpin to an elaborate electronic communication system That would be the equivalent of the heart of what we have in NATO, for example, Armstrong said in a PBS Frontline documentary. It was creating a new theater of war. On October 28, 1981, the Senate narrowly approved the AWACS package, 52-48. 4 days later, Armstrong's front page article in the Washington Post outlined a secret plan that had never been confronted in the congressional debate. An unwritten agreement lay behind what had been framed as merely the sale of 5 airplanes. In return for an integrated package of highly sophisticated military technology, Saudi Arabia would build a massive network of naval and air defense facilities that could sustain U.S. forces should they ever be needed to protect the region or wage war against an aggressor. The Saudis had no problem footing the bill. By 1981, Saudi oil revenues had reached $116 billion a year. The Saudi Monetary Agency was charged with the task of investing nearly $320 million a day. Over the next decade, the Saudis bought $200 billion in American arms and built 9 major new ports and dozens of airfields all over the kingdom. A beneficiary of the military buildup was the Saudi Bin Laden Group, which built facilities for the Al Salam Aircraft Company. They have now hundreds of modern American fighter planes and the capability of adding hundreds more, said Armstrong. More than a massive military buildup, the U.S.-Saudi alliance constituted a major shift in American foreign policy in the Middle East that took place with virtually no public debate in the press or in Congress. It's absolutely phenomenal, a $200 billion program that's basically put together and nobody's paying attention to it, said Armstrong. It is the ultimate government off the books. Even more secretive was the new understanding that Saudi Arabia would become a U.S. partner in covert operations, not just in the Middle East, but all over the globe. As a monarchy without the constitutional constraints that burdened the CIA, the Saudis had enormous flexibility to help the Reagan administration execute covert operations prohibited by Congress. Not long after the AWACS sale was approved, Prince Bandar thanked the Reagan administration for the vote by honoring a request by William Casey that he deposit $10 million in a Vatican bank to be used in a campaign against the Italian Communist Party. Implicit in the AWACS deal was a pledge by the Saudis to fund anti-communist guerrilla groups in Afghanistan, Angola, and elsewhere that were supported by the Reagan administration. And so, Saudi-American relations were becoming an ever more complex web of international defense and oil deals, foreign policy decisions, covert operations, and potentially compromising financial relationships between Saudis and American politicians who shuttled back and forth between the public and private sectors. Increasingly, Bandar, who was appointed ambassador in 1983, just after Fahd became king, was at the heart of these operations. He was learning to love politics. "When I first got to America, I didn't understand politics," he said. "I was confused by it. Then it became like a game, like a drug. I enjoyed the game. It was exotic and exciting. There was no blood drawn. It was physically safe, but emotionally tough." Officially, the United States was neutral in the Iran-Iraq war. But from the onset, two factions within the Reagan-Bush administration battled over which country posed the greater threat to U.S. interests. That struggle became the most acrimonious foreign policy conflict within the administration during the entire Reagan-Bush era. One bloc, which was led by National Security Advisor Robert Bud McFarlane and two members of his National Security Council staff, Howard Teicher and Oliver North, argued in favor of arming Iran. Their rationale was a variation on the old saw that the enemy of my enemy is my friend. In this case, since Israel's biggest enemy was Iraq and Iraq's enemy was Iran, the McFarlane faction proposed moving toward Iran to enhance Israeli stability. The other faction, led by Secretary of Defense Caspar Weinberger and Secretary of State George Shultz, was virulently opposed to Ayatollah Khomeini's fundamentalist regime in Iran. After all, failure to oppose it could allow Islamic fundamentalism to spread throughout the region, endangering pro-West governments in Kuwait and Saudi Arabia, and thus America's oil supplies. It was insanity, said Weinberger, How could you send arms to the Ayatollah when he was sworn to destroy us?